Praise the Lord. We bless the name of the Lord for bringing us to the end, to the concluding point in the Congress of this year. And we pray that the blessing of God will rest on all those who have ministered one way or the other, or those who have served in one area or the other. As you have served the Lord and the people of God, the blessings of God will go with you and abide with you in Jesus' name. We do appreciate everyone, and we'll continue to pray for one another. Let's close our eyes for prayer. Our Father, we thank you and we bless your name. Thank you because of the way you have ministered to us through our preachers, through our singers, through the various workers, leaders in various sections. It's not only those of us who have spoken, not only those of us who have preached. As we have interacted together, we have seen the glory of the Lord and the beauty of the gospel. We are praying, O Lord, all that we have learned from one another, you'll use everything to strengthen us, make the work better, and make the message richer, and make our lives to have more impact in the lives of people around us in Jesus' name. As we come to this session now, help us to discover your will, your plan, your purpose for the church. And as we do, we are praying, O Lord, the grace to do everything that needs to be done. Grant unto everyone in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. In Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. In that single sentence, you see what the Lord himself says about the church. He has a purpose for the church. He has a plan for the church. There's something he wants to accomplish through the church and in the church. And as we all yield ourselves to him, the Lord himself will fulfill his purpose in Jesus' name. In this new millennium, the various church locations and church denominations, they're going to have different attitudes, and they're going to have different approaches. The attitude, the approach each church will take will determine if that church is going to conquer, if that church is going to have the victory and fulfill the purpose. Some churches, as they see the world of media, the world of technology, the world out there moving in a particular direction, some will compete with the world. They will say, see where the world is, see what the world is doing, and then they will want to use the same method of the church, compete of the same method of the world, compete with the world. Number two, some will compromise with the world. They will say, we want to reach the world, we want to get the world, and there is something we have to do. We have to bend a little, yield a little, give up a little, compromise a little with the world so that they will be able to reach the world. Number three, some are going to try to cooperate with the world. They're going to get into partnership with the world. And they're going to say, if we're going to reach the world, we need the people of the world out there, come in partnership with us. And it's a kind of give and take. Other people, number four, they'll comply with the world's expectation. The world is going to dictate to them. The world is going to say, wait, church, you want to catch us? You want to reach us? We are the people you are looking for, and we can tell you what it is will get at us. And that those kinds of churches, they're going to listen instead of listening to the Lord of the church. They're going to listen to the world and comply with the world's expectation. Number five, some will conform to the world standard. They will say, well, the world is out there, and the world is going its direction. There is nothing we can do. If we're going to do anything, we need to conform. Number six, some will condescend to the world's level. They'll say the world is down there below. And if you are up there in your ivory tower, and you are calling them to come up, they will not come. Get to their level, interact with them, do what they do, drink what they drink, go where they go, that's how to get them. I want to tell you that all those churches, as they compete with the world, compromise with the world, cooperate with the world, comply with the world, and conform and condescend, every one of them, they'll collapse with the world. And they'll be conquered by the world. What we need to do, if we're going to see what the Lord has in mind, that he will build his church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church, is that we understand that Christ has not abandoned the building of his church. It is as we discover all that he has in mind, and we go along with him, and we're guided by the Spirit of God, that we will realize in its full measure the purpose, the plan, the progress that the Lord has concerning the church. There are 3 points we're going to quickly look at. Number one, Christ's purpose for a living scriptural church. Christ's purpose for a living scriptural church. Number two, clear principles from the last seven churches. We have them in Revelation chapters 2 and 3. And we have some clear principles there. Clear principles from the last seven churches. Number 3, consistent progress through loving, steadfast Christians. Consistent progress through loving, steadfast Christians. We come to number 1. Number 1 is Christ's purpose for a living scriptural church. If we're going to fulfill the will of God and the mind of God, what is it we're going to do? How do you discover the purpose of the Lord? Number 1, look. Number 2, listen. Number 3, learn. Number 1, you look at the commandments of Christ. What has he commanded? You look at Christ's ministry on earth. How did he do it? He went about, he taught, he preached, he healed. And then he gathered disciples around himself. He trained those disciples that they should go where he himself will want to go. Study the life of Christ, the ministry of Christ. When he was on earth, look at Christ's ministry on earth. Number 2, listen to the commandments of Christ. What has he commanded? What imperatives has he given us? Number 3, learn from the early church. The early church has a lot to teach us. And as you go through the books of the Acts of the Apostles, and you see from chapter 1, and you go line after line, verse every verse, and you see what the Lord himself made the early church to do, as you learn from that early church, you'll see the purpose, you'll see the pattern for the church. It's well defined, clearly defined over there. But briefly, the ministry of the church, the purpose of Christ for the church, is that we do 3 things. Number 1, evangelize the community. Evangelize the community. Number 2, edify the Christians. Edify the Christians. Number 3, equip the committed. And that, in brief, those 3 things tell you very clearly the pattern, the purpose, the thing the Lord is expecting that church leaders will do. Number 1 is to evangelize the community. Every community. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And then it says, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And it says, lo, behold, see, I am with you always. He will be with you, even to the end of the world. And everybody said, Amen. Evangelism, soul winning, crusades, in whatever form, with all effective methods. That's what we are to do, so that we'll carry out the purpose. Number two is to edify the Christians. As the people are getting born again, you want to disciple them. You want to develop them. You want to make them understand Christian discipline. How does a believer live? And that's why we're told in Acts chapter 20, verse 28, take it to yourselves, take it therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock, over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. What are we to do? Feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. You see what the Lord wants us to do? As we go back to the various localities, locations, countries, continents, anywhere we came from, it says we're to feed the church of God. You remember how the Lord, after they had dined, and he asked Simon Peter, he said, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he said, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. He said, feed my lambs. He asked him three times, and he was telling him, feed my lambs and feed my sheep. That's how we're going to edify the people of God, edify the Christians. And Paul the apostle, didn't he testify? He said, wherefore I take you now to record this day, that I'm pure from the blood of all men. Why did he say that? Because he said, I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel, all the counsel of God. Let me remind you of what Paul told Timothy in his last letter, last epistle. He said, Timothy, preach the word. That's how you edify the Christians. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Because the time will come, and the time has come, when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own laws, they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away from the truth, from sound doctrine, and they shall be turned unto fables. But it says, but you, as you have been here, and we have drunk together, and we have eaten together on the table of the Lord, the bread of life has been given unto us, but you, thou, you watch in all things, you endure afflictions, you do the work of an evangelist, and the work of a teacher, and the work of a pastor, and the work of a prophet of God, announcing the soon coming of the Lord. It's as you do that, you'll be fulfilling the purpose of the Lord. But then the third part of that point is to equip the committed. As you bring the people together, you'll find those who are committed, and those people that are showing commitment, they are showing that they have a call to higher service. It's like the Lord has been telling them, come up higher. And as they have been responding, the Lord himself will fix them up. But then you train them, you develop them, you equip them, you equip the committed. In Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verse 11, he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why? For the perfecting, the maturing, the developing of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's what we're to do. Now we go to point number two. Point number two, clear principles from the last seven churches. You will need to do this by yourself. That means you have to take time later and read chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation. But as we look at these, you will see, one, the condition of all those churches. Number two, you'll see the commendation of some of the churches. Number three, you'll see the condemnation of some of the churches. As we look at the condition and we look at the commendation, and we look at the condemnation of some of those churches, it makes you understand what Christ is expecting from the church. And as you glean principles out of those last seven churches in the scriptures, here is what you find. Number one, dedicate yourself in laboring to preach the whole truth. Dedicate yourself in laboring to preach the whole truth. You know what he told the Ephesians church? He says, I know thy works. He says, I know thy labor. He says, I know thy patience, how thou canst not bear with them that are evil, and thou hast tried them which say the apostles and are not. You have found them to be liars. In fact, he commended them because the people have not followed the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which sin I hate. Number one principle, dedicate yourself in laboring to preach the whole truth. Number two, dissociate yourself from preachers of error and disallow those who contradict the truth from teaching your congregation. Do not open up your congregation, your church. Do not give your pulpit to the people that contradict the truth. It says, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which also I hate. And then number three is to demonstrate the grace of patience with people and perseverance in circumstances. Those are the principles we'll see. As we look at those churches, you will demonstrate the grace of patience with people and perseverance in all things. Remember what he said, you are born and you have patience for my name's sake, and you have labored and you have not fainted. And then in number four, devote your life and ministry to love fully and love truly. Love fully and love truly. Devote your life and ministry to loving fully and truly. Because it says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against you because you have left your first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works, or else I will come to thee quickly and remove the candlestick out of its place except thou repent. Number five is to deny self and embrace the cross of persecution fearlessly and faithfully. You will deny self and you will embrace the cross of persecution. He told one of those churches, I know thy works, and I know your tribulation, and I know your poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, and are the synagogue of Satan. But fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. That means then you will deny yourself, you embrace the cross. Number six, dare to accept the challenge of planting and pastoring a strong church in the most difficult place on earth. The challenge is thrown at us that we shall accept that challenge to plant and pastor a strong church in the most difficult place on earth. Revelation chapter 2 verse 13 says, I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. Even though for that minister he was in a place where Satan's seat is, but thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my name, even in the day wherein Antipas was the faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Satan was even making the place his headquarters, his capital, but they had a church there. Why don't you then dare to accept that challenge? Plant the church, pastor the church in the most difficult place on earth. Number seven, determine never to permit, unknowingly overlook, immorality or any open sin in the church. Never permit and never overlook any open sin in the church. Because the Lord rebuked one of the ministers. He said, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou permit, thou sovereign, that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants, and to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed to idols. Therefore you will determine that as you are going back, you will not allow a Jezebel, a Delilah, anyone that will bring immorality or propagate immorality or defend immorality in the church. Number eight, direct your efforts to the conversion of unsaved church members. There are some people in the church that are not born again. They have a name that they live, but behold, they are dead. Some are hardened sinners. Although they are in the church, they have not been born again. Therefore, you direct your efforts to the conversion of the unsaved members of the church. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Number 9, discern and detect open doors of opportunities. And even though you have a little strength, believe that with that little strength, you will accomplish great things for God. Discern and detect open doors of opportunities. And with little strength, you'll accomplish great things for God. He said to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, he said, these things says he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David that openeth and no man shutteth. And then he says, that shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I've set an open door before you. No man shall be able to shut it. For thou hast a little strength and hast kept my word and hast not denied my name. Number 10, depend on Christ's power and his unfailing promises. Depend on Christ's power and his unfailing promises. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet. Amen. And to know that I have loved thee because thou hast kept the word of my patience. I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell on the earth. Number 11, declare and defend the truth. Declare and defend the truth, holding fast the truth, whatever the cost. Defend, declare the truth, holding fast the truth, whatever the cost. Revelation 3, 11, behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Number 12, deal with lukewarmness, lethargy, self-satisfaction, and indifference in yourself and in the church. Because he says, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. The Lord is telling us that we will need to deal with lukewarmness. You find that you are lukewarm, there's lethargy there, there's indifference, or there's self-satisfaction. You will tell the Lord, remove this sin away from me. Let me be on fire for the Lord. And the fire of the Lord will keep burning in your soul in Jesus' name. Number 3 now, consistent progress through loving, steadfast Christians. Consistent progress through loving, steadfast Christians. The Lord wants us to understand that it's as the members of our churches, where we come from, it's as they are well taught, they are well led, they are well fed, and they remain consistent and steadfast and strong in the Lord, that the church will have progress. You know, Acts chapter 2, from verse 41 to verse 47. Verse 42 in particular says, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, and in fellowship, and in the breaking of bread, and prayers. And it says in verse 47, praising God, and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church, the Lord will add to your church, daily such as should be saved. In Colossians chapter 4, verse 17, say to Archippus, and the Lord wants me to say to you this morning, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received in the Lord, that thou fulfill it. Our prayers are going with you. And we believe that the power of the Lord will never fail in your life. You will accomplish the ministry that God has committed into your hand. It will be done. I said it will be done. And if Jesus tarries and we have opportunity of coming back, you will, by the grace of God, have testimony in your mouth. As you come next year, if Jesus tarries, in Jesus' name. I want to remind you that as you go, you'll be lifting up the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he tells us in John chapter 12, verse 32, and I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself. How do you reach the masses, men of every tribe, men of every birth? For an answer, Jesus gave the key. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself. Don't you know already? Our children told us last night, the world is hungry for the living bread. Lift up the Savior up for them to see. Trust him and do not doubt the words that he said. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself. Don't exalt the preacher. Don't exalt the pew. Preach the gospel, simple, full, and free. And prove him, and you will find this promise true. I will draw all men unto myself. Lift him up by living as a Christian ought. Let the world in you, the Savior, see. Then men will gladly follow him who once thought, I will draw all men unto myself. Lift him up. Lift him up. Still, he speaks from eternity. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto myself. As you are going, therefore, let it be your determination. Let it be the single purpose of your heart. You will exalt the Lord. And when you preach, exalt the Lord. When you counsel, exalt the Lord. I told you last night, we exalt him. Because there is none else to exalt. And I said, it's the ambassador and the arm of the Almighty. It's the backbone of the brave. Maybe you find that you are a coward. He's the backbone of the brave. The captain of the conquerors. He's the defender and the defense of the defenseless. The emperor of the elect. The forerunner in the fight of faith. Is the governor of the great. Is the head of the heroes. He's the image of the invisible God, the judge of the jury, the king of kings, the lord of lords, the leader of the legislators, is the master of the mighty. He has the name that's above every name, is the overseer of the overcomers, the powerful prince over principalities and powers, the qualifier of the qualified and the unqualified, the ruler of the regents, the sovereign over the supreme, the timeless truth. Above any teacher from any seminary, the umpire of the universe, the vigor of the victors, the wisdom of the all-wise God. Stand up and lift him up. Exalt him. Exalt him. As you are going, make up your mind. This is what you are going to do. You are going to preach Jesus. You are going to preach Christ. You are going to tell the lost world out there how they can find Christ. How Christ will be their savior. How Christ will be their sanctifier. How Christ will be their power, their baptizer. How they will recognize Christ as the coming king. Preach Christ. Preach Christ. Preach Christ. Exalt him. Exalt him. Exalt him. And if you exalt him, he will draw all men unto himself.
I remember I came here without scholarship to Howard University. The first year was amazing, but I got a grant that paid half of my tuition. But then from second year, I got like 5 different scholarships from my department. I just thank God. Third year, the same thing. And I thank God because I'll be graduating in May. I